Just a reminder that I'm going to continue today with Revelation chapter 8 and 9, but I'm not going to read anything from 9. It's too long and it's too complicated really to do this today. So I ask of you to continue to read the book of Revelation. Next week we are going to do a little bit of 9 and then chapter 10. And you can read chapter 11 also, but please help yourself and me by just studying the book a little bit more. Another thing is the section I'm going to work on today is so complicated, chapter 9. I'm going to do it in 4 minutes or maybe 3 minutes. I can have 3 or 4 sermons on that one section. But I decided not to do it because, remember I told you, the book of Revelation is like a parallel thing where you have a story that's told and then the story is retold again and retold again from a different viewpoint. I'm not going to focus on that section now because in a week or two or three, we're going to get to this again. And then I'm going to tell you somewhat of the world history and how what's going on now in Israel and all of those things are actually taught in the book of Revelation. Not today, that will come in a day or two or a week or two when we get to that point. So if you read chapter 9, you say, Ferdy, but you skipped out now a lot. Don't worry, we will get to this later on again because the story is going to be retold, but then from a different viewpoint. So, before we start, let us pray. Oh Lord, we come to you this morning and we thank you that you came to us. That's the most amazing story in the Bible that I constantly find as I page through this amazing book. You are a God that could have just left us alone. All the things in the sky that's now peering deep into space actually finds nothing except darkness, cold, and maybe some beauty. And here we are, the small planet that's orbiting around a small sun that we call our sun. And you have made this place. You have given us this place. The only one that is blue with all the water on it and oxygen and life and beauty as we are surrounded by it. We are astounded. You as God thought to do this and then to create humans to relate to get to know you, to understand that there's way more to life as we find out in Alpha than there is to what we see and perceive. You came to us, and without you coming, we would have not known you. We thank you for this. We walked away, but you came after us. So thank you, Lord, for your word, and thank you for this amazing book of Revelation that we can open up today and continue to discover what you want us to know about life, ourselves, heaven, and God. Bless us as we gather in your name, and bless us as we know you also came to us today. Amen. Countless of time I've heard these words in my office. I'm not really sure if I can continue with this relationship. A man or a woman sitting in front of me. But let's make it a woman today and blame the man for the rest. And I would ask why, and she would say, because I don't think he listens to me. Now, that's true. I remember Louise and I were married for less than a year, and she sent me for someone to test my ears. You know, she said, he's not listening to me. I told her I couldn't hear, but okay. Right. But that's a common thing in a relationship, isn't it? That we do not always listen to the other person well. I say, I did not hear what you said. But when they end up in counseling, it's way more than just not hearing. It has to do with what I've heard so many times. I'm not valued. My opinion is not heard. My reality of how I perceive and experience life is in no way treasured or even recognized. Why am I even here? What is my place, my space in this person's life if this person continues just to discard me to the side and I have no value? Why do I even want to be in a relationship when it's like this? And many times it then ends up in people eventually, if they do not come for counseling about communication, that the relationship really starts to struggle and it may end. The same is true about our prayers. I've had countless of people in my life sit with me and say to me, why do I even need to be part of a church? Why do I even need to call myself a Christian or want to be a Christian? Because what benefit is there for me? I spent an hour a week in church and there's no benefit because I can't see that my prayers are working in any way. In no way. I've prayed so many times for this person in my life who's important to me not to die and he or she died. I've prayed for this person in my life that's important to me who is extremely sick to get healed and the person is still struggling with cancer or whatever illness this person has in his or her life. I've prayed for this situation in my life that needs to be resolved and 30, nothing. Nothing. Now you tell me it's worthwhile to believe in God. You tell me it's worthwhile to be in this relationship with God. Does He even care? Does He even hear me? Am I even anywhere on His radar, somebody said to me, or is God so busy with the rest of His world that I am completely lost in all the things that's going on? That my voice is too small to be heard. Maybe one of the reasons why so many people have walked away from the church or from God in a sense, because we ask of God to respond to us in a way that would serve us, that would work well for me, that I feel at least valued and I feel at least recognized in what I want. Today in the section I'm going to read with you from the book of Revelation, you'll discover, I hope, that you do have value. And I do have value. And let's read this. When the lamp opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. And I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets were given to them. Another angel with a golden censer came and stood at the altar, and he was given a great quantity of incense to offer with the prayers of the saints on the golden altar, that is, before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints rose before God from the hand of the angel. Then the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from the altar and threw it on the earth. And there were peals of thunder and rumblings and flashes of lightning and an earthquake. Heaven, full of sound. If you go and you start to read Revelation chapter 1, you will find it's a place of sound. It's a place where at some point John said it sounded like a huge waterfall. You know, it has this noise, but it's never irritating. It's like this impressive sound, and it was God's voice speaking at that point. You'll find thousands of millions of people worshiping God, and there's harp playing, and there's all of these instruments playing, because constantly there's praise and worship and all of these great things happening in heaven. It is the family of God together. Think of the best party you could ever go to in your life with family and friends that are in great accord with one another. Not one of those where, you know, Uncle John is mad at the, you know, sitting in the corner. One of the best possible parties you can imagine where everybody's just enjoying themselves and there's music in the background. That's heaven. That's heaven. God is inviting His people that He created on this planet to have a relationship with Him back into the garden, back into His presence. And there's this huge celebration where God is glorified and praised. And we're going to do a lot of stuff. That we'll find out later on in the book of Revelation. We are not going to only sing. You will do at least something fun. It's all going to be good. A place of noise, sound, good things. And then there's silence. Now, for half an hour, we have no idea why the half an hour is really mentioned. Some people say it may have to do, with the preparation that the priests had to go through before they went into the Most Holy. Because that normally would take half an hour, the preparation, but that's not important now. And one of my friends once said, you know, Ferdy, I said, what? He said, there's one family member of mine that will never be able to go to heaven. I said, why? He said, well, he or she can't stop talking, and there's supposed to be half an hour of silence in heaven. Nah, that's impossible with this person. You've been to a wedding celebration, and at some point you hear this. or on a glass, or on a microphone, there's this tapping noise, because people are talking and there's music playing, and slowly the music starts to fade and there's a silence that starts to enter the room. And the moment when the silence enters the room, you know that there's going to be an announcement. There's something going to happen that's important. Either the bride or the groom are going to come in or whatever. There's something going to happen that needs now my attention. The place of sound and celebration suddenly falls silent, quiet. Yeah, what did you now do to Lida? Come on, Jared. Oh, yeah, you know, yeah, she's... I can't speak about silence when there's no silence, can I? I'm just kidding. There's silence in heaven. Why? Because an angel steps forward with this censer, and it's a golden censer that was sort of what they used in the temple in the old days. And in the old days, in the center, you would only have incense, this great smelling thing. But now he brings not only the incense, he brings the prayers of the saints to God. Why is the prayer of saints mingled with this incense? Because in Romans chapter 8, you will find that Paul says, you know, our iniquities, our struggles with God is in a sense covered by the Holy Spirit that even prepares our prayers to be brought to God. And I sit and I think to myself, so it means that the prayer that I have prayed now found its way into the presence of God in such a mighty way that it becomes silent in heaven. And the prayers that are brought to God are not only the prayer that I've prayed this morning, but it's all the prayers I've prayed in my life. When I was a little boy and I would kneel next to my bed because I was afraid of the dark outside and maybe the thunder and the lightning and whatever was going on in my life, that prayer is still in front of God because God remembers all our prayers. He would never disregard our prayers because our prayers are so important to Him. So if you've ever in your life wondered if you've got any importance, I think here it is, but we'll get to that in a moment. But then there is God's response to our prayers. And this is now the tough part that I need to share with you a little bit. The angel then goes and he gets fire and he puts this in the same center that our prayers were in, just to connect then what's now going to happen with our prayers. And then he throws the fire down onto the earth. And it says these rumbles of thunder and lightning and then an earthquake. And if you go into the Old Testament, you will find any time when God was present in a mighty way, there would be all of these things in nature to remind people, but mighty God is now showing up. And then the trumpets. You see, in the middle of the section, you heard that there were seven angels standing there, and all of them were given a trumpet. And the trumpet has always been sort of the thing that would call people to the square of the town to tell them there's something important going to happen that they need to know. Or it tells them to go to the walls because there's an attack coming and they need to prepare themselves for the battle that's coming. So on the one hand, the trumpet calls. On the other hand, the trumpet warns. Seven trumpets given to the angels and they start to blow these trumpets. The first four talks about stuff that happens on land, then things that happens in the river, then things that happens in the ocean, and then things that happens in the sky. Please go and read this afternoon after you've had lunch, and I promise you, you will not have your afternoon nap after you read all of this that's going to happen. Because it's quite disturbing, because it is the stuff that you and I see on TV. It's what we see on TV. If you watch TV or listen to the news, you will many times hear about floods that's destroying houses and homes and livelihoods. Sometimes when you watch TV, you hear about things that's happening in the ocean. You go, there are storms coming in from the ocean. If you look at the sky, there's a hurricane coming. You can see the clouds turning and twisting and all of these things. All kinds of bad things happening in this world. And God is connecting that with our prayers. What have I prayed to cause this? I would ask myself. And then it continues, the next three trumpets blow, but I'm only going to say about the first two. Then it says the second or the fifth trumpet is blown, and then you find all of this evil that's unleashed in this world. And you and I have sometimes watched news or listened to what's going on and say, how is it possible that people can be so evil? Then you discover humankind in trouble. When COVID happened and people started to die all over this world, we all got extremely concerned. And I said to this, Revelation chapter 9, that's where it's at. And also later you'll discover it again in 11 and 13. That the Bible tells us that these plagues will come and these diseases will come. And here in this chapter it says that a third of humankind will be wiped away. Now, not a third of humankind was wiped away, but that's just a symbolic number to say a lot of people will die. And now we sit here and we ask ourselves, what's going on here? And then there's the eagle flying by and he says, whoa, whoa, whoa. It's like this surreal moment that's happening, and we are trying to figure it out. It starts off with prayer and it ends off with this. What is going on? Let me explain real quick. It has to do with a call to repentance. The rest of humankind who were not killed by the plagues did not repent of the works of their hands or give up worshipping demons and idols of gold and silver, bronze and stone and wood, which cannot see, hear or walk. And they did not repent of their murders or their sorceries or their fornication or their thefts. I started off by reminding you that I've had so many people in my life sit in my office and say, I can't continue with this relationship because I'm rejected and ignored. I have no value. Why do I need to even continue? You see, chapter 8 of the book of Revelation tells us that God values us, who values Him. You see, that's the problem. The problem is that we are surrounded by people who reject God. We are surrounded by people that ignores God. We are surrounded by people that gives to God no value. The biggest insult, I think, to anyone sitting in this building today is when somebody completely ignores you. You try to connect with someone and that person just ignores you, doesn't even answer your email, doesn't even acknowledge your existence. God says, I have shown myself in so many different ways in my Son who came to this world and to all that I have done that the world may know that I am the only holy living God, and they reject me. They ignore me, they turn their backs on me, and they expect of me to do nothing. They expect of me not to judge, not to start to slowly unfold my judgment upon them. And He says to us as Christians, as His children, I know it's going to hurt and harm you also, but you are marked with the seal of Christ Jesus on your forehead. What we did now, we baptized the child. It has nothing to do with the water. It has to do with the fact that you and I have the seal of the life of Christ, the death of Christ, on our foreheads, in a sense, to say that we are claimed by God in a world that's broken, that God is slowly but surely judging. And when you and I fall on our knees and I say, Lord, help me with this life. Please help me with all the things that's going wrong in my life. God says, Ferdy, I've got it, but see further than what you only ask me. I am judging this world based on also what you experience. Based on what is happening in your life, I've got it. I know about the evil in your life. I know about the brokenness that you are dealing with every day. I am slowly but surely unfolding my plan of salvation in this world. And part of my plan is to judge, to keep people accountable. But not only to keep them accountable, to save them. To save them. When that eagle flies and he says, whoa, 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 all the commentaries say it is as if nature is calling out to humankind and say, look at the storms, look at all the bad things that's happening. How can you not want to turn to the only one that is the answer in life, because this world is totally broken. This world is totally broken. And I'm so sorry, it's not really going to get better. Because we are never going to have heaven on earth. Heaven is not here, heaven is there. And as time progresses, it's going to get a little bit harder and harder because the world is going to reject God more and more. And God says, I'm not going to allow this. I am not going to allow this, that you treat me in this way and hope for me to bless you. How can God bless sin? He can't. What does faith mean? Faith means that at some point in my life, I looked at the sky, I looked at the tree, I looked at the Bible, I looked at the story of Jesus, and I said to myself, I believe there's a God. And I believe that this God wants to be in a relationship with me. And I discover as I read the story of Jesus that this God regards me and gives me value. This God really wants to listen to me because without Him listening to me, I would not be saved. Because God knows my deepest need in this life is not a great car, great health, or great whatever. My deepest need in this life is to be in a good relationship with God. And that's why Jesus came. To address the most important need that anybody may have in this world, and that's to be connected with God again. So faith means that I see God. Faith means that I start to talk to God. But faith also means that I give God value. And how do I give God value in my life? By allowing Him to say to me what is important to Him. Isn't that what the problem is in relationships? That I would like to tell God constantly what I want, but I do not listen to Him. I do not accept His direction or His reality. God says, Ferdy, for a moment, just shut up with respect. Keep your mouth shut and listen to my word, and you will discover why life is so complicated and that I'm not done with this world yet. You are important to me. I listen to you, but my son, I'm on my way through a broken world with you. There's one thing you need to know. I hear every prayer that you pray. They're in front of me. Yesterday, it's Henri's birthday, was on Friday, and yesterday we were at their house and there were a lot of her friends and they were all sort of in the pool and some out of the pool and whatever. And it's time for us to have our lunch, burgers and dog stuff, and they asked me to do the prayer. I wonder why. They always ask me to pray wherever. And I always tell them, it's expensive. But they asked me to say the prayer, and I said a short prayer asking the Lord for my daughter's life, that she's lived for 36 years, and for being there and the food. And when I said amen, I didn't tell them this. I stood there for a moment and I thought to myself, to me this was just with respect a quick sort of prayer. My prayer caused silence in heaven that God could listen. Will I ever in my life pray a prayer without thinking about this again? Hopefully not. If God gives so much time and attention to what I'm saying, maybe I should give way more time and attention to what I'm saying to Him. Maybe my prayers should be dealt with such respect that I will never in my life say, let's say a quick prayer, but say, let's talk to our Father. Who's going to in heaven? Silence. Let's hear what Ferdy wants to say. Let's hear. And then after God has heard, I'm reminded by His word that God says, I will not give you every single thing that you've asked. I will answer your prayers in many different ways, but look at the world around you. You live in a broken world that is shattered because of the sin of people. But I'm on my way, my child, because you're sealed. You're my child. And I will bring you to where I want you to be, even though there may be tears on your cheeks and illness in your body and suffering because of the hardship of this broken world. But my child, I hear your prayer. You are valued. You're a child of the only holy living God. A God that gets us. Amen.